I forgot to do that before I got on.
What the world needed, love. Yeah.
This is a very, very important topic that we're going to have tonight. It's about substance abuse and treatment with our WOW director, Tonya Moon. I'm just going to tag some people. I'm really excited about sitting down and speaking with her about this. I've been really wanting to do this.
Gotta watch out for the flesh, just a mess. When the record was a down to him, all used up. In this whole round, then he came up to the ground, made sure brother all done, all chewed up. Fresh step, yeah, gave me a new look. I went skydiving off in that good book. Now I'm all up, only got a true look. Christ on the real value in the blue book. Christ keep me in line, keep me shook. I know who behind the scenes.
I'm trying to share it.
Share. We're going to talk about a very, very important topic tonight. It is substance abuse. We've been losing a lot of celebrity. Please tag and share. Please tag and share. What we're going to do is I'm going to begin to
what we got to remember that Jesus Christ came for us all. You know, love comes with multitudes of sins. So with all that being said, we got to come together. We got to love one another, no matter what the color. Hey, let's love talk.
Hello, hello, everyone. We're going to get into a very, very important discussion tonight about substance abuse. I have asked Tonya Moon to come and sit down with me. I've been really wanting to do this for a while. And we're going to talk about substance abuse and treatment and how it's affecting not just the Black community, but just the Hall County area. In general, I'm going to give it over to Tonya and let her introduce herself and let us know about all that she has going on and that she's doing.
Hey, everybody. Well, most of y'all know, if you don't know, my name is Tonya Moon, and I have a nonprofit for homeless women and children. Is that mine? Let me turn that off. It may be mine. I have a nonprofit for homeless women and children for single moms. And we target mostly the extended stay hotels here in the Hall County, but not just Hall County, just wherever there's a need with a mom and her children. And one of the things, they may be bound to drugs and alcohol, it may be hardship or whatever it may be. We just try to, our organization just try to supply the resources that's already available in the community. We're not reinventing the wheel. We just try to gather up the resources that's already available and take it and put it in people's hands that may or may not know about it, and especially in the rural areas. We kind of focus on that. And what I'm doing now, I'm just kind of resetting. We haven't did a whole lot because of the COVID. I think the community is just opened back up. We got permission to go up there for the fall months and do some things with the women's, but just being very careful. We got one or two WOW members was COVID positive. One is in the hospital right now. So we're just really being really careful with our volunteers right now. So that's about it.
Yeah. Yes. I know, Sister. So I wonder how the whole COVID thing, how is that affecting the drug, people who are, is it people starting to use more drugs or turn more to drugs? What you think is going on with that? Because I know with myself, this is just been.
For the ones that we have been serving, the pandemic did do something. They was already without going through for whether they were just homeless, and they didn't necessarily have to be on drugs. They could have been just homeless. But the isolation, when the community shut down, the resources got real limited one time. They did what they did to keep from being cold in the winter months, keep from dealing with the reality. There was no shelters open. The shelters that was open, you couldn't come in at the time because they had no way to, at the time, to test the ones that was out there, and they didn't want to infect the families that was already in the shelter. So they used more. And it's gotten, I think it has gotten even crazier as I go and service the ones that I know they're out there on drugs. It used to be years ago, where Renee, it was an expensive drug. Now $3 can get them high for hours and just a few dollars. And so it's a whole different ball game out there. It's a whole different, it's just a whole different generation. So things have really changed. You got disorder, you got mental health out there, you got homeless out there, you got children, you got youth out there. It's just a whole different world out there than when I was out there. So I tried to go out there in the field with a different mindset, not thinking that it's the way it used to be when I was out there, because things have changed. I have to go out there with an open mind. I have to go out there and listen to the people, why they're bound, what's causing them to stay like that. And a lot of it's just because of some real bondage from childhood. Just some issues and scars they hadn't dealt with, and they just not ready to face their demons or face those issues, and they numb it by doing what they do. And so I try to go out there with, like I said, with an open mindset, because it's just different. You got to listen now. And there's other drugs out there. Heroin is out there. Heroin wasn't out there 20 years ago. Heroin has always been around, but it wasn't at our fingertips like it is now. But now you got adolescents tapping into heroin through the pills and manufactured pills and stuff. And so you got the dark web market where now they can get them if they're not in the streets, they can get the drugs delivered at their door now. So it's a whole different ball game. Yes, ma'am. Yes, wow. Ma'am. Yes, ma'am. There's browsers and this website, the dark market where you can set up a whole identity. And of course, we have protected services. We have so many people on there trying to protect our children and protect us. But again, you could go on the website and order just about anything you want and get it packaged at your door. Of course, now you don't know what's in it. they can be tricked, they can be deceived, they can have the money taken, but 9 times out of 10, they may get something in that package. So it's just so many ways to get these drugs now. And it's something else. And with the addiction behind the back pain, whether someone is have a health issue, they become addicted through that. I know people that wasn't addicted, but had an injury, and over the years they've gotten family members. Y'all have a safe trip. Family members that had some health issues, but over the years they became addicted to the pain medicine. So it's all kind of levels, all kind of it's all kind of levels of it. It's a lot. It really is, and you can't ever educate yourself enough about it. Just when I think I know this, and something else is, and it just blows my mind. It blows my mind. And sometimes I feel like I'm fumbling around trying to turn a switch on in a dark room because I don't know. So I'm always trying to talk to people. I may pull up in our community to some of the ones that I know I've been knowing for years and just have a conversation with them. Just have a conversation with her. And that's mostly how I get my information, just having a conversation and, you know, and talking to different counselors in our community as well. But I think the real experience come out there when you're talking to someone that is bound and sharing how they can get it and where they can get it and how easy it is and why they do what they do. And it's just amazing. The information you can get from someone that's found. Yeah.
I didn't know they had went online.
Yeah.
Oh Lord, that's a lot. So what are some things that you feel in that sense? Everything has changed. I don't even know where to go from there because my questions are probably so old. I'm thinking from the old days. I'm not thinking from now. What is an addiction? Can you kind of just explain that to us?
Addiction is something that you depend on. For instance, I was talking about someone that may have an accident and they have a prescribed narcotic to them or to relieve the pain, but their body have a tolerance for it. And after a while, it's misused and your body will grow a tolerance for it and you begin to crave that feeling. You begin to crave whether it numbs you, whether it takes you from reality. It keeps you from thinking about what's at hand. It takes away the pain for a moment, and you don't want to hurt physically, emotionally, or mentally. You don't want to think about anything. And so we medicate ourselves with something that numbs the pain, and we become addicted to it, not knowing we're addicted to it, but we become addicted to it. When I start using, I did it recreation so many years ago, and I was following the leader because someone else did it. I did it, and I was working every day, no children, and I did not know how addicting cocaine was. Well, it started with the alcohol, the LSD, and it just gradually, once your body get a tolerance of one, you get a tolerance of weed, and then you want something a little stronger. You get a high tolerance for alcohol. It no longer make your back stop hurting and no longer numb the pain. You want something a little stronger. That was my cycle. And before I knew it, I wanted going to bed. I wanted before I got up in the morning. I wanted all during the day. My attitude changed. I quit working. I started to lie, steal, and cheat. It just take you away from who you are. And that addiction will make you do things you never thought you would do. Never thought you would do. I never thought I would shoplift. I never thought I would walk out on my kids and my husband, my family. I never thought I would go to jail for doing crazy stuff. I did everything that you could think of because of my addiction. My body craved it. I had to have it. It's a physical craving. It's mentally. And I hear a lot of people say, oh, it's just in your mind. After a long period of time, it is a physical craving, and it's a physical addiction as well. And so there's a process of detoxing to get it out of, especially, and it depends on the drugs itself. Heroin is a totally different detox than cocaine, because one is an upper and one is a downer. Where heroin makes your bones ache and your body ache, there's a whole different detox from it. And people use it after so many years of addiction. They have to have it because the body is so dependent on it. Their bones ache, there's vomiting, there's all kind of things that your body do when it's addicted to it and it can't have it. And so it's not, and there's a lot of times you're trapped. You don't want to be like it, and you want to come out, but you don't want to feel the pain. You don't want your bones aching. You don't want to vomit all day. You don't want the night sweats. There's a lot of things you go through the detox to come off of some of the drugs. And so a lot of people stay there because of the detox is so horrifying. I don't think the movies share enough light on it. You know, we see some of them where they're trying to detox an individual, and you see the sweats and the shaking. I don't think it does it justice. But it just depends on the drug. But yeah, it's something that your body craves mentally, physically, and emotionally. You got to have it, and you will do anything for it. It's something that has been abused, and your body began to crave it. It's a craving for it.
Can you use one time and be addicted?
Yes. And the reason I say that, because that one time you don't know you're addicted. That one time it don't take you way out there. That one time you just feel good. And you be like, why is it making him act like that or her act like that? I got this, you know? And it just mellow you out. It could be weed. And it just smelling you out. And you don't want to go and break no laws. You just, as they say, you just cooling out, you know. And but not knowing that you're going to chase that feeling again. You're going to want that high again. And so that's where the addiction come in. To do it and enjoy it and put it down. Most of the things that we enjoy, mm-hmm. we don't put it down.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah, most of the things we enjoy, whether it be drugs, alcohol, or sex, it may be out of the will of God. But if you enjoy it, 9 times out of 10, you're not going to put it down unless you have a relationship with God. But most of the time, if you're way across the street, you're not seeking God at the time. You just, you know, you're doing what you do. And you don't realize that your body is creating addiction at the time, because you think it feels good. It yeah. takes you to a place you never been. It's a lot of hallucination in it. It takes you to a place mentally that you know, a trip that you never been on. And so, and when you come down, you're like, wow, you know, and you want to revisit that. You may not do it back to back, but somewhere down the line, you know, you'll do it, you'll visit again. So yes, it can be addiction. You can use one time and be addicted.
Wow. Do having family members that may have been an alcoholic or already on drugs, how do that affect, like, if a new user, like, this is my first time using, but it's already like a history of it in my family, do that play any kind of role or anything like that in it?
I think it play a big role. I've heard a lot of testimonies where it play a big role. If I watch family members down through the generation of years of my grandparents or my uncles and my aunts using it, drinking it, and when they used it, it seemed to be a fun thing. They use it as a recreation. And so when I get old enough, guess what? I want to do what Uncle Uncle Cletus do. I want to get me a beer and, you know, the males, you know. And so, yes, I think it's because we do what we see. And I think, yes, I think it is. It can become it's a generational curse. It don't have to be. I've seen a lot of people that come out of alcoholic families and did just the opposite because they did not want to do what mama and daddy did. And they broke the generational curse. I've seen that. But I've seen a lot of it because dad did it and Papa gave me beer. Oh, little Bill won't hurt him. And Papa gave me a beer and I was turning up cans of beer at 9 or 10 years old. It has its consequences. By the time I'm 14, I'm a full-blown alcoholic and don't even know it.
Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah. I know I didn't touch, that's the reason why I didn't touch anything, because my dad was an alcoholic and I seen that and it was a turnoff for me. If you were watching a family member, how would you know that they need help or that they are addicted? What are some signs of someone using?
Well, you start with your adolescents. I think it's different levels. You just have to know them. For our children, you have to really monitor and know them, know their routines. It could be a weight gain or loss. It could be a moody attitude. It could be now the things that used to be open about, the hiding things, the cheating. And don't always have to be drugs and alcohol, but most of the time it's something wrong. So if they're lying all the time and now they're hanging out with the wrong people or hanging out with people they normally wouldn't hang out with, and you used to talk and now there's a distance, you know, that's something to look at. And especially for teenagers, but for a family member, their behavior patterns just change. You know, what they used to have good work ethics, they no longer have it. Now they can't hold a job down. Their word used to be everything. Now, if they say one thing, they never come through. If they're married, you know, because there's something wrong there. They're not spending time with the children. The wife begin to see patterns. Mm-hmm. There's a money shortage. The bills are not being paid on time. Every Friday they're gone, or when that payday come around, there's no money and they're always gone. It's not always a side chick. It could be that habit. It could be that addiction. And you'll know, you really will know, because everything changes. And sometimes it doesn't change overnight. Sometimes it takes us a minute to grasp it because we're so good at hiding stuff. It'll take us a minute, but the addiction, the drugs cost. So I think the easiest way to detect it is financially. You'll see that, financially, you'll see it. In a household, you will, in a family member, financially, you'll see it. Because with that, like I said, the lying, the cheating, the mismanage of money, all of it just kind of follow each other. Because if I work 50, 60 hours a week, and my normal thing was to deposit, and so you can pay the bills, and every week I've got an excuse, something happened, or I'm putting the hours in, but it's not measuring up. Something is wrong. I'm short-tempered. Everything bothers me. I'm aggravated. And when we don't have that drug in us, we're moody. Mm-hmm. Everything bothers us. We're easy to be aggravated and frustrated, or we can even become violent. Because of that, we're so aggravated because we don't have our drugs, that drug of choice in us. So it just affects everybody different. But you have to watch for the patterns, watch for the signs, the people that they're hanging around. You know, a lot of times they say, well, you can't judge. You know, yes, you do. If you know Bobo hang on the corner all day long, and then next thing you know, you see Uncle P, we getting out of the car with Bobo. Normally, any other time, he don't, you know, he's not fooling with Bobo because he know Bobo down there on the corner hustling, and him and Bobo riding together, something, open your, you know, something's wrong with that picture. And I'm not saying that we throw away people when they get out there on the addiction, because a lot of, I'll pick people up, I'll bless them and take them, give them rides, and where you going, and yada, 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 because I'm going that way. Doesn't matter what they're doing, you know, they still respectful. Thank you, T, for giving me a ride. You know, mm-hmm. I'm not saying that, but you will not see me standing out at the green store hanging out there with them. If I'm out there, I'm ministering, I'm loving on them, I'm taking resources out there, but I'm not out there to stand out there and hang out with them. So, yeah.
Yeah, that makes sense. That makes a mm-hmm. lot of sense. Mm-hmm. You know, what would you say to a family member that's dealing with someone on drugs? Okay, we see the signs, we see the side effects, we see the mood change. What do we do?
You know, that's a good question, Renee. I have several family members with my brother. Let's use him. He's been off and on. He was staying with me, living with me. You know, I did another live and testified how he came to church, and he was just ready. 2 days later, he was back out there. When you see the signs, you're going to end up making some decisions, because the addiction, it cannot be controlled. And if it's a spouse or if it's another family member, eventually you're not going to be able to stay in the same house with them. You're not. Because the addiction will lead to lying, cheating, and stealing. And you cannot help them until they want to be helped. You can offer them resources. You don't throw them away. My brother, Ken, when he's, I'm sharing this because this is part of my testimony, but one day hopefully he'll give you his, because I'm still believing God. I don't allow him in my house when I'm not here, but somewhere in my house, around my house, he has access to get to the shower if he needs to. Someone is here. They monitor him while he's here. They allow him to come in here, take a shower. Once he take a shower, he can fix him food. He can even pack things to take with him. He won't come to once or every other week or something. He don't run in and out because he's doing his due. But I love him. I don't want to see him hungry. And I don't want him out there stealing because he's hungry. You know, I want to make sure, you know, I'll go by and say, come take your bath or come change you some change clothes. When I was out there on the corner, I didn't want to be out there, but my addiction had me out there. And I wish somebody would have stopped and said, T, I got to change your clothes for you. Come and shower. Nobody stopped and said that. Most of the time, we don't look at people. I seen Michael Fisher do a live on 9th District, really blessed my soul about the homeless. Most of the time, we don't look at them eye to eye because we're afraid they're going to ask for us. So we don't look at them eye to eye. If we're driving, we look the other way.
Yeah.
I don't know why, but we do. We'll look the other way. I don't know if we're shot. Mm-hmm.
We're scared they're going to ask for something.
We're ashamed of them, but we'll look the other way. So, yeah, but he have access to what I need. But to answer your question, I think you just have to monitor it. And when they get to a place that is threatened, it's going to threaten your livelihood, the language changing, using profanity, the whole demeanor changing. And of course, you do what you have to do. Offer them help, but you need to get them, distance them away from your family, the children especially. And as sad, as quiet as it's kept, there are so many things that they're using, so many drugs out there. Let me say this without saying it the wrong way. Some drugs, some of those demons, some of those spirits behind those drugs will have you to do some very ugly things, even to children. You have to be careful. It doesn't matter if it's a family member. if you know they're under the influence. You say, well, Uncle Joe been drinking for 30 years. That doesn't exempt Uncle Jojo for seeing something or looking at that 10-year-old little boy. So you have to monitor your children. You just have to really, really monitor it. Loved ones or no loved one, you have to remember there's an addiction going on, and we can't put things. We can't put the addiction ahead of anything. Doesn't make them a monster. You use discernment. You be safe. You make decisions. If you want to help them, you help them. But you do it where you're protecting you. You're protecting your loved ones, and you're not enabling them. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Because we don't want to enable them. One thing I do, I tell my brother and others all the time, I say, I'm not going to enable you. I love you, but I'm not going to enable you. Now, what if I give him a few dollars, do I worry about what I know what he's going to do with it 9 times out of 10? But I don't just give him money. Sometimes I need some stuff done around here, and I go pick up him and 2 or 3 more and say, I need some guys to do this and that to help me do something in the basement, pick them up or do something at the church or whatever. And I pay them. I pay them. I give them $12, $13 an hour. If it's going to be an all-day thing, we're going to do something in the morning around the church. I pay them. What they do is their business. But my brother, I won't constantly give him money. I'll feed him. I'll keep clean clothes. He have access. He got 2 or 3 tubs that he can come and change. And if somebody's in the house, he have access to go in there and clean himself up. But he'll keep his dirty clothes in a certain place, and I keep them clean for him. That keeps him from just coming and going in and out my house when I'm not here. And it may sound mean to someone, but it's gotten to that level over the years because his addiction is 20 years out now. Wow. And so he's never taken anything from me. That I can say about everybody's addiction is so different. What he do out there, now he may steal out there. He may get somebody dope out there. He may steal the dope man. I don't know what he's doing out there. But one thing I can say, that he has never picked up anything in my house, sold it, pawned it up. He's never done that. I'm aggravated with him. I think my aggravation come in because you are not allowed to go out there for 2 weeks, burn yourself out, and come in here and rest for 3 days, sleeping and eating, and don't want to go somewhere and seek change.
Mm-mm. Wow.
Go on out there and get tired. I'm not doing that. I'm enabling you now. I'm giving you a place to sleep for 2 or 3 days to get your rest, to go back out there and do it again. So I just don't do it. I don't do it. And I've had other family members to say that I was mean. That wasn't the way to deal with it. But 20 years out, he's a veteran in this thing. He's got to be tired of being sick and tired. I'm doing a live right now, no man. So.
Wow. So what are some tricks? Let's spend a little bit. I see where we're at on time. Let's spend this last couple, I guess, 30 minutes or so talking about what are some treatments? How can a family member, is there anything a family member can do to try to say, okay, you need to get some help, and kind of point them in the direction of some help? What are some treatment? What's out there? What's available?
Well, you know, once you detect what the problem is, or because a lot of times, what if there's mental health involved? Drugs may not really be the thing. It may be that they're using drugs, but they're not really addicted. They're just off their medication, but they're smoking a little weed or they're drinking a little bit. So I think we got to really just detect what's really going on with them, know what's going on. And again, until they're ready to get help, there's nothing we can do but keep resources in front of them. Look, when you're ready, do your research. Find out if you don't have insurance. And when they get tired of being sick and tired, make sure you have on hand resources that would take them in. If you know they got a criminal case, they're on parole, they're on probation, make sure that you have found a rehabilitation center that would take them off the street with an open case. Maybe they can be on parole or probation, because a lot of them, if you're on probation or parole, they don't want to take you. Make sure that they take them without insurance. A lot of them don't have insurance. A lot of them, you have to have insurance. So you have to do your research and find out what's available out there. There are rehabs out there for people. For instance, if there's mental health and drug addiction going on, we got Avita Community Partners in Gainesville has all kind of resources. They do. They have resources for women and for the children. So you just have to plug into some of those resources. Do we have a lot of resources for women in this community or rehabs? Not really. We don't. Now, that's because it's mental health involved, and they do have resources. But if I'm just on heroin, on pills, on Gucci, and I'm just using meth, and I want to go get some help, where would I go? Then there's places in Lawrenceville. We have resources for North Carolina. We have resources for Tennessee. There are places that you can go. And most of the time, I try to find resources that you don't have to have insurance. Who have insurance? They've been in the street 10, 5, 8, 9 years or 9 months. They're not working. Most of the time, the family has just kind of cut them loose from everywhere. So they don't have insurance. So we try to find resources where they can come as they are. And most of them be Christian faith. They're faith-based ministries. Because I think at the end of the day, once we get our mind cleared, we have to, for me, it was 3 months to get my mind clear and I detoxed. But somewhere in that treatment center, they would say higher power. But somewhere in that, in my rehabilitation, I knew that I couldn't do it without God. I had never, ever been to a rehab. But this time I was tired. I wore about 75 pounds. I was so little. I was so little. I wish I had pictures. I said I was going to have pictures for this live, but maybe we'll do it again. And I had pictures where I had been to the Hall County Detention Center, and you would not recognize me. I was so little. I might have been 105. I might have been 100 pounds wet if I was that heavy. You could not hardly recognize me. I was so small. And I knew I did not want to go to sleeping in abandoned buildings and abandoned cars, sleeping in crack houses. And so tricking to eat, to get up, to feed myself. I chose that pad. My addiction took me there. And I did whatever I had to do to keep that addiction up. But after 2 or 3 months of detox, I had to make a decision that I wasn't going back. So somewhere down the line, I remember getting out of 6 month treatment, and I remember getting on my knees and calling on the name of Jesus and asking God to help me. You can't do it without him. I tell people I've never relapsed because I was genuine and I was sincere about my sobriety. And I never have said I won't relapse. And I tell people I have another relapse in me, but I don't have another recovery. For what I know now about the enemy, mm-hmm. I know I wouldn't make it back in. Giving up would just be that. It would just be that. And so I would never say I won't ever go back, or I don't have any desire, but I'd never say never. But what I do know is that I have a relapse in me, meaning I'm subject to do it if I walk away from God, but I don't think I ever make it back in. So daily I have to guard that. Daily I guard my sobriety by saying with God, if I disconnect from God, it's not about anything else. I'm going to go back to my vomit. And that's drugs and alcohol. That's my vomit. I'm going to go back to being homeless. I'm going to go back to the jails and the institutions, and I'm going to go back to the drugs. So I can't disconnect from him. If I ever unplug from him, that's where I'm going back to. And so it's a life and death situation. It's a life and death situation. If I don't do nothing else, I got to stay plugged in just so that I can live. Just so I can live.
What would you say to somebody that's struggling? Because I know some people, I've even reached out to you before and said, hey, Tonya, I got some people, they didn't follow through with it. But what do you say to some people? They may be watching right now that's struggling. I mean, they got clean and went back, they get clean, they go back. I mean, what would you say to somebody that's dealing with that?
I think accountability is important when you're on a journey of trying. You have a desire to be clean, but I think accountability is missing that. I had a sponsor, I had a mentor, I didn't have a prayer partner, because remember now, I'm going back and forth to the Halt Club. I wasn't in church. I gave my life to Christ, but I hadn't got there yet. But I had accountability. I had people calling and checking on me. And they was picking me up and taking me to meetings. I had so much accountability for that level, for where I was. And so I think we try to do it on our own, but you can't. You're going to have to find you somebody that you can give your stuff to, that you can trust, that can sponsor you and help you walk that thing day by day. And if you fall, you got to get back up. Don't stay down there. If you fall, if you go get high again, get back up. See, it's not about you falling. It's not about you falling. It's about you staying down. Wow. Get back up. Get back up. The shame, the guilt, and the remorse keep us out there for years. I know people that fail and want to get back up, but Renee, because of their shame, they're guilty because they was in the church doing great things in the community, and they fail. And they feel like, you know, I might as well go on and just do what I do. Nobody will ever, you know, my credibility is gone. My dignity is gone. Nobody will ever believe me again. You know what I'm saying? But I think the problem is that we don't get back up. But I think accountability for the ones that's struggling, because accountability, that person is going to cover you. They're going to pray for you. They're going to check on you. They're not just going to call you. They're going to walk with you. You know, it's not about preaching at you and throwing the word. Yes, we got to have the word, but it's not about preaching to you. You're the choir. You know the song. You know, we don't did this thing. You know, but it's holding you accountable to what you say you want to do. You say, I want to do this, and I have a dream, and I've always wanted to do this, then I'm going to push you. You know, somebody that accountability will push you, will hold you accountable to what you say you want to do, will help you and direct you and guide you through prayer and put tools in front of you so you can attain that dream that you shared or that, you know, they'll let you start dreaming again. They'll help you start dreaming again. It's accountability. It's having somebody to walk with. And I think a lot of time we try to do it on our own, and that's where we mess up, even on this faith walk. We can't do this by ourselves, Renee. We can't. You know, if I didn't have you and a whole lot of others, I wouldn't be here. we can't do it on our own, you know? So I think having that accountability to help us and pull us and encourage us and celebrate, and girl, you did good, and celebrate us for the small steps. Sometimes the small steps don't look small to our family. Be like, oh, she's been doing that for 10 years, but that's a small step this month, because you don't know how I went through and I almost got high. And it may not be much to you, but that's big for me, you know. And so it's got to be somebody who have walked in them shoes that understand it. If you have never walked in them shoes, it's kind of, you know, is, you know, people are kind of turned off from your help, you know. So I've never done Gucci. I never smoked a Gucci before, and that's my brother's drug of choice. And so some days I don't know how to reach it because I've never used it. And so all I know is to say, Ken, I talk to him and plant seeds when he's sober. I said, I know you're tired. I said, but guess what? We love you. And if God can do it for me, I said, all you got to do is give me 1 year, give me 2 years, stay sober. Your dream is to drive 18-wheeler trucks. I promise you, I got people in place that'll get you on the road. I promise you. I try to encourage him and inspire him that you can dream, you can still attain that stuff, the spirit so far in you because of the addiction, because of all the things you're doing. That's about all I can do. I don't know what the drug is, how the drug is making him feel at the time, you know, because I never used it. I don't know the addiction of it, but I know it's systematically. I've heard a lot of things about it. I've seen him laying and on his back and foaming at the mouth, and I've seen all of the symptoms of it, but I've never used it myself. But from what I've heard and what I've been told, that is so addicting. It is so addicting. To me, that's scary, Renee. That something so cheap, something that you can get for $5, $2 or $3, you know what I'm saying? That can lay you out like that. Mm-hmm. And you don't have to. Usually when I was getting high, $20, and it was gone in 15-20 minutes. It was an expensive high. They used to say it's a rich man high. Now they got drugs where you could take $5 and stay high for hours, you know, or whatever their drug of choice is. And that's crazy, but I guess that's why it's just so, it's so many people drug of choice now. Yeah, you just have to love on them. And when you get the opportunity, we can't preach at them. We just got to continue to speak life into them, drop seeds in them. Let them know that you love them. Let them know that they still can dream. They still have access, what God said they have access to if they'll surrender. And when my brother come around me, I said, Ken, you know, he came about 2 weeks. Well, that's about, but he's in jail now. He came about 2 weeks ago. He was going to get a job. And I said, you know what? If you give me 6 months, I promise you, I'll help you get into driving school, help you get your CDL. 6 months, you can stay here rent-free. I'll take you. I'll do whatever you want me to do. We'll work on your credit. I laid it all out for him. But at the end of the day, it had to be his choice. He wasn't ready. He wasn't ready.
You know, I'm having a lot of people that I deal with. I try to say what you just said, you know, but a lot of them complain about that, that 12 step. They're like, that junk don't work. And them people make me more depressed. So I don't know nothing about it. Kind of speak on that. I wanted to talk to you about that because a lot of people, I said, well, you know, we got this in the area. We got that. And when I started that, I'm not going in there. Those people just going to go in there. They're just going to talk about their drugs. They're gonna, I come out more depressed and want to use than when I went in there. I mean,
You can't go to some meetings where they romance the drug and they do. When you get come out them meetings, they talked about this and that. When you come out of there, you almost, you're so tempted to go get high. I think it's not about the 12 steps. It's really, we both know it's Christ, but we have to meet him where they at. But I do know of one. It's called Celebrate Recovery, Life Recovery. And it's the steps with the Word of God. They offer it up there at the First Baptist on Green Street. Now, due to the COVID, I don't know the doors, but you can, they're all over the world. You can type it in and say, Celebrate Recovery Near Me. And they'll give you the times. They'll give you, usually they'll feed you. They'll have a 45 minutes. They'll eat a meal and then they'll go into it. And so it's more of a life-changing experience. They're touching issues and they're touching things on the inside. You know, they're dealing with the issues on the inside that causes us to use on the outside, if that makes any sense. Versus say you go into the Hawk Club and they say, hi, my name is Tonya. I'm an alcoholic. And you're telling your testimony, and by the time, you know, four or five tell their testimony or whatever, you got a lot of miserable people. They're only in there because they're court ordered. Some, a handful may be in there because they want to be in there, but a lot of times they're court ordered, they're miserable. I had the opportunity to see it firsthand of somebody that's sober, but yet can be miserable at the same time. That's crazy to me, but I was able to witness that. They were sober because the court say, if I drink, I go to jail. If I mess up, I'll lose everything. So I'm only sober because of that. And I'm gonna stay sober, but just as soon as that, as they said, they lift that paper up off of me. Yeah, so a lot of them won't go to it because they feel like they've done it before, they're being made to do it. When we have court order, I've got a mentee, she's been clean and sober 14 years, and I've had the opportunity to walk with her all of those years, and she's clean and sober today, walking in her purpose. But the thing is, she went to jail. And she found behind the walls, she found Jesus there. And I know a lot of people said, well, you go to jail and you get religious, and you know, God just meet us. You just have to be a decision to surrender. And if they don't surrender, Renee, it just don't work. Nothing works. You have to want it. You got to want it. You do the same thing, you will get the same result. You got to want it. If you're not ready to get sober, we might as well leave them alone. I mean, to the point where quit fussing, quit pushing, quit all that. Because until they want to get sober, they're not going to do it. I used to tell my mom when my kids was little, my husband, they would come and he would say, Tonya, you know, just come and comb the girl's head. And I said, you comb their head. You the dad. That was mean, that was selfish, it was all about what I wanted. At the time, they was babies, and that was not a priority. Mm-hmm. My addiction was my priority. Not being a wife, not being a mother, my addiction was my priority. I miss prom, I missed all of those birthdays. I hear a lot of parents, I celebrate so many when I see Tawana Welcher is one of her son. I love Loretta Hood and Edwina, and there's so many on Facebook that I went to church and I know through social media. But when they put their kids accomplishments on there, I am so proud of, as though they was my nieces or nephew. I'm proud to see any child do something and make it, and it's positive. I'm so proud of the mothers, because I don't know what it is to walk across the stage or see my babies walk across the stage. I missed out on so much as a parent that I celebrate so many other children's, you know, because I missed out on that. And you can't turn the hands, you can't go back, you know. Only thing I can do now is be the best parent, the best mom that I can be today. It took years of forgiveness. So for those who are, it took years for them to deal with my addiction. I was sober and there was still a lot of bitterness. There still was a lot of angry because I wasn't there. You abandoned me. You wasn't there. I was mistreated. This, that happened to me because you left me. There's consequences for our actions. And I had to come back and I had to deal with all of that. And I had to ask God to give me the strength to help me stand because I did make those choices. Now I'm better, but guess what? Now I got grown kids that still have scars on the inside of them. And so I thanks be to God that the healing is still a process. I won't say that they delivered. I see our relationship is so much greater today. Our love is genuine today. I don't feel like I'm trying to make up for yesterday. There was a season in so many years I felt like that. But today, I thanks be to God that we are just working on. I quit trying to make up and be their mom, and I had to just allow them, ask them, can I just be your friend? And I know a lot of people don't understand that because I missed out on the mama days. Yeah. Can I just be your friend?
That's good.
And it's your choice if you want to call me mama. And then for a long time I was T, but today I'm mama to all of them because I've shown myself worthy. I've walked in the journey long enough to earn their trust again, to earn their respect again. But it took years to do that. And so there's still a lot of bridging. My baby girl, there's still a lot of bridging that have to take place. I have other grandchildren that I never see because I think there's still a lot of deliverance. She's still angry, bitter. You know, she loves me. She calls me. She says she loves me. Now, I know she does, but there's still some pain down in there that God has to deal with. God has to heal her. And it's going to be in God's timing. So I have to back up and be patient and accept whatever she allow me, whatever space she allows me to be in her life, whatever time she gives me, because I don't deserve any of it. Wow. But whenever she allow me to be in her life, allow me to be around her children, then I'm grateful, Renee. And I don't push it. I don't push it. So, yeah. So I'm still after 21 years, we're still healing on this side. We're still healing. We're still healing. And we still got a long way to go. It doesn't happen overnight. It does not happen overnight. We got a long way to go. Yeah. And I even see some of them walking in some of the footsteps that I walked in. And I know we're about out of time, we're over time, but I think that's the most painful thing to see them walk in the same. I heard you say, I didn't follow my dad's footsteps because it was such a turnoff. So I didn't do it. But to see some of your children's kind of visit the areas that you do, I can't say don't do this and don't do that because you're grown. But let me tell you what's in the room waiting on you. Let me tell you what's in that dark room. And once I tell you what's in the dark room, it's up to you to turn the light on, to flip the light on. But let me tell you what's in the dark room because nobody told me what was in the room. I walked around in the dark room and I didn't know. But so today I can tell them, this is what's waiting on you if you make that choice or that decision, because you're in the same room that I was in. Nobody's going to tell you that, but you're in the same room that I was in. Let me tell you who in there waiting on you. And once I do that, I cover with prayer and I back up. And they have to live their own life and get their own testimony. But it's a process. It's still a process on this end with 21 years of sobriety. It's still a process. And so I take all that energy and I focus on trying to help somebody else. So I don't worry. I don't let the enemy bombard me about she don't receive me, or I can't see my grandbabies, or this and that and the other. I take that energy and I do something positive with it. You know, I celebrate other people's kids. And I go help somebody else. And while I'm doing that, God is working it out for me. He's working that thing out. And one day, me and my kids going to do a live. And we're going to be able to talk from my perspective and their perspective. That's one of the things on the altar. And I just believe one day it's going to come to pass. But if anybody's out there that have a family member or want some resources for confidentiality, you call me. I'll give you everything I got for us. Resources, rehabilitation centers, what's free. Because like I said, it's a lot of them that don't have, you don't have to have insurance. So just get in contact with me. I'm on the book. You can message me. And if you need that mentorship, or if you need someone to just be an ear to walk with you, it's not everybody's business. Reach out to me. Reach out to me. I love you for right where you are, because I know what it is to feel alone. Yeah. I know what it feels like to feel alone, you know, and like nobody understands. You want to come out, but you can't come out because of the addiction. You know, I know what that feels like. So holler at me. And if anything I can do, if nothing but talk, sometimes just allowing someone to vent and to share where they at, it helps a whole lot. So I'm here for the community if they need me. But again, I have the resources of the rehabs, the treatment centers. We got a lot of good stuff in our community. We don't have as much for the women, but I do have some resources for women.
Awesome. Guys, you hear, please reach out to her if you need any information or you want to know about treatment centers. I know when I'm trying to help somebody, I'll say, hey, Tonya, I need help with this. Because I really don't, that's out of my jurisdiction. I mean, I know a lot of people that are on drugs and I've been around it, but trying to help somebody, I lose that kind of patience, I guess, because I don't understand it.
Yeah. You know, can I say this to Renee while I'm on here? And the Lord just dropped this in my spirit. For those who are watching, there's other great giants that is a professional. I don't claim to be a professional or drug counselor or anything like that. Miss Myra Muckles, that is her field. She's a great counselor. She's a first lady. Most of all, she's a woman of God. Reach out to her. Reverend Michael Holcomb, he works at a treatment center, Turning Point. Reach out to him. Miss Teresa Payne, she works with mental health and disorders and addictions. Reach out to her. We got some great people in the community that's already plugged in some of these places, and a lot of times we just don't know. So Miss Teresa Payne, Reverend Mike Holcomb, and it's on top of my head. Who did I say, Reverend Mike? And Miss Myra Muckle, First Lady Muckles. So those are three giants in that field that I know that will be willing to help you, direct you, guide you, or lead you if you have any questions. Because as I said, it's just my experience. I'm not licensed. They're licensed in that area. They do it for a living every day. So if I couldn't answer something, or if I didn't answer something, those are three great people to reach out to. And I promise you, they have some resources for you.
Thank you. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Look, I wanted this to not be too long. Will you have anything in closing that you want to say and just pray us out?
No, I think that's it. As I said before, you know, we just have to have a lot of awareness. We have to just have a lot of discernment, and the way that we used to deal with stuff, we have to inform ourselves. Get on Google, Dr. Google, get your resources, get your information. Every day something's different about the drugs and how they're given. As I said, the dark web, it blew my mind when I realized how many people was getting heroin and dope off the online. So I'm always trying to get the dirt on drugs, you know. So, you know, it's such a war out there. And so the best thing to do is to continue to educate yourself, because if you have children or grown children, God forbid, we don't need to be out of, we don't need to be clueless about their struggles if they go down those roads. We need to know how to help them. We need to have some resources or connect it to people that have resources. Again, reach out to Miss Myra Muckle, Mike Holcomb, and Miss Teresa Payne. They're great leaders in the community. They're already plugged in, and I know they wouldn't mind helping you or giving you some resources and leading, you know, and guiding you. Yeah.
Yeah, because you know, we just had DMX. And what Keisha Cole mother.
Mm-hmm.
I think it was it overdoses or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a serious thing. Mm-hmm. And I it tears the family up to watch it, you know.
It is. And quiet as it kept, you know, we don't wanna repeat stuff and say stuff, but quiet as it kept, we had a few in our community. And so we need to talk more about it, you know. Quiet as it kept, you know, we don't want to say we're so and so OD'd, but the truth of the matter is we have loved ones, we have friends and family that's using, and they don't have to be homeless, they don't have to be on the corners, they could be working at it every day and just be tired. And just, you know, not wake up the next day.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's real. It's right here at our door. It's your next door neighbor. It's right here in our community. It's quiet as it's kept.
Yeah. And let's see, I saw something too about a man he was on. I think he may have said heroin. I know you was talking about that. And he ended up killing a young girl, and he didn't remember doing it. So, you know, it's real serious, and we see it in our communities. I know I see it when I go out to walk my dog. You see them people like this, and they not moving, and they, you know, you all these people walking around them, and they not aware that you around them, and they drooling at the mouth. I mean, you see it.
Absolutely.
And they end up, well, you out there playing with your kids.
It's everywhere. It's just not, you know, it's not, people often want to say it's the homeless issue. Most people are homeless because they're just in hardship. Everybody homeless, not on dope, you know. It's working people. It's people that that's functioning households and driving and pulling out the driveway next door to you every day, and you know, come home one day and you hear this and that happen, you know, and it's like, what happened? And you never know. So and sometimes it's not that, you know, that we just abuse prescription drugs. It may be due to an injury or some back pain, as I said, and it becomes an addiction. So you just don't never know what's going on in somebody's household. So when we see it or we detect in their families, we just have to educate ourselves so we'll know how to approach them and handle them. You don't want to beat them up and accuse anybody anything. But the more we know, the more effective that we can be. Yeah. So I'm always looking at the type of Gucci, looking at it, all of it looked the same to me. I'm always looking at the different names, Dead Man Walking, this and that and the other, so many names for it.
Wow.
And I'm just like, wow. And I see my brother one day, he was trying his best to get in my driveway. It took him literally 10 minutes to walk four steps. Because he was trying his best, and it was like he was in slow motion. And I sat there, and normally I'd say, get yourself in this house. But I sat there, and I allowed, because I needed to see it. I've never seen it, and I needed to see it. Mm-hmm. And he was trying his best just to get something, but he couldn't function. And when he did, he just kind of leaned out, and I don't know if that's if heroin is in the weed or what, but it's a downer, you know. And I seen how it had him all you know, how it made him, and it was just it was an eye opener for me, because like I said, if you're not around it, then it becomes an eye opener. We could talk about it and other people talk about it, but until you see it, yeah, and see how it affect people, yeah, it was an eye opener for me. And I was like, wow.
I have to agree.
Wow. Yeah, it was an eye opener for me. So yeah, I just try to educate myself so I know I'll be as prepared as I can be to help somebody, my children. I got children out there. And I pray in the name of Jesus, they never have to go and, you know, they never get addicted to some of the stuff that's out here. They don't use it. But again, they got their own journey. So,
yeah. Hard to watch, though. It's hard to watch.
It is.
I love one. So.
Mm-hmm.
This has been good. I thank you so much for coming and sharing it now. You want to pray us out, and I'm going to get my thing because I don't want us to go dead while you're praying.
Okay, so. Okay. Yes, yes, yes. Thank you for allowing us to be a part of Senior Saving Dating. And I just thank God that you're always recognize something in me that the community might can use, or whether it be my testimony or a resource. Thank you for just always creating that platform, that space for us. Precious Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day, God. Lord God, we thank you for the opportunity to come into the community to just share our strengths, our hopes, and our struggles, God, to share some resources. God, we just thank you. I thank you for what you brought me out of, God, that I might be a living witness, God, to tell somebody that there is a true living God. There is a God that will bring us out. Father, there's a lot of things going on in our families, our loved ones, and in our community, but God, we know that you are a healer and a deliverer. We thank you right now, Father. We pray in the name of Jesus, you will continue to put a shield of protection around our children, especially our younger children, God, as they prepare to go back into the school system, God. Put a shield of protection around them, God. There's so many things and so much evil out there. Watch over them, God, in the name of Jesus. And then, Lord, give us wisdom to how to handle our loved ones that may be bound to drugs and alcohol, God. Let us stop pushing them away. Let us stop judging them. Let us stop shunning them. But Lord, give us wisdom and discernment, Lord, how to love them and how to direct and guide them and get them the help that they need, starting with me, God. I say tough love sometimes, but God, sometimes I'm pushing them right back into the enemy territory. So God, give me wisdom how to do what it is that you call me to do, God, in the name of Jesus, God. We thank you for this platform. We thank you for this woman of God who continue to put resources in our community, who continue to put others up here to share with us and learn us and inform us about what we need to know, God, concerning our people, concerning our family, concerning our loved ones. I pray in the name of Jesus, you continue to be with her and continue to lift her up, God. Give her everything that her heart desires. Send everything that she needs that she can keep going forward and doing what you call her to do. It's in Jesus' name that we ask it all. And every heart say amen. Amen. And bless God. Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Thank you for coming.
I love you, Sissy. Thank you so much. Thank you for the opportunity. I sat outside because I knew I have awful Wi-Fi, but I'm about to burn up. It's hot as fish grease out. God bless y'all. I heard a comedian say the other day, I said, Lord, I ain't heard that in a long time. It is. It's hot as fish grease out here.
Thank you for bearing the heat and being
I know it, right? I love you.
I love you too. Thank you guys for hopping on. Thank you for tuning in. Those who get the replay, if you got any questions, just go ahead and put them in there. I can always relay them back to Tonya. and connect you with her if you need any more information. I want to say thank you, thank you, thank you, everyone. Have a good evening, and we love you, and be blessed.
God bless you. Good night.